wired for sound. He doesn't know I'm a, well, I guess he does know I'm a retired school teacher, so believe me, I can make the end of the row eyes water if I want to without a, without one of these things. So can everybody hear me all right? I am honored that so many of you came out tonight at 6:30 on a Thursday, the day before the blizzard's supposed to hit, to listen to us talk about the Montana Central Railway and the book that came out in June that we did on that. I'd like to introduce my wife over here, Jan. If you'd stand up, Jan. Jan's very much a co-author of this book. She's the one that keeps me on task in the writing and does a lot of the research, so she's a very big player in this. About a month ago, she was over here talking to a similar group about the last spike ceremony that the Northern Pacific held at Independence Creek over near Garrison in 1883. So tonight we're going to talk about the second railroad that came into Helena. This one, of course, is the Montana Central Railway, which always was and was built by what became the Great Northern Railway under the direction and ownership of James Jerome Hill. So, do I just hit the arrow here, Brian? Stupid computers. This is the book. There are copies of it out there, and it's not my intention tonight to do the whole book. We would be here until midnight, and I know you've got other things to do all of that, and so it's always kind of a choice to decide what you will talk about and what you won't. There's nothing like writing a book to make people think you know something about the subject. And so I guess what I'm here to tell you tonight that you can write a book and you can know a lot about the subject, but you still have questions when you're done. And I always equate historical research to a series of flashbulbs going off. You get these little flashbulbs that illuminate something, an incident, an era, some people, a place, and then it's darkness, and then you get another little flashbulb down the line, and the trick of research is to get enough of these flashbulbs going off that you can sort of intuitively string it all together and come up with a story that is historically accurate and entertaining and actually informative. But that doesn't mean that you've answered all the questions. There's still the dark spots, and every once in a while you get surprised. So tonight we're going to talk a few of those dark spots, some questions I have, and then entertain your questions. If you've read the book, great. Thank you for doing that. If you haven't yet, hopefully tonight we'll feed your curiosity a little bit, and you might want to do that. We are just 5 days short of the 126th anniversary of the arrival of the Montana Central Railway in Helena, Montana. It and the St. Paul, Minneapolis, and Manitoba, its parent, had started construction in Minot, North Dakota Territory in April of 1887, and in the course of one building season, they built all the way from Minot, Dakota Territory, through the Missouri River drainage to what's now Havre. Havre wasn't there yet. And then southwesterly to Great Falls, which was barely there in 1887. And without even giving the crew a night to celebrate the completion of the St. Paul, Minneapolis, and Manitoba to Great Falls, the next morning they began laying rail on an already prepared grade to Helena. Another 90 miles south, and they arrived here on November 19th. Somewhere in the neighborhood of 650 miles of construction in a single construction season between April and November, a record that is still unsurpassed anywhere in the United States to this day. And I guess the question is, what was the rush? Why all this frenzy to get here? Well, some of it is to understand this man, James Jerome Hill. When I started this book, it was my intention to not do another biography of James Jerome Hill, and to not do another corporate history of the St. Paul, Minneapolis, and Manitoba and Great Northern. And I ended up doing both because you cannot separate the railroad from the man. And I trust you all know something about him. He's known as the Empire Builder today. He was the president of the Great Northern Railway up until about 1907 when his son took it over, Louis Hill, and made it into one of the premier railroads in the United States. It was the second transcontinental to come through Montana. And it still, to this very day, serves as the Burlington Northern Santa Fe main line through the northern region of the United States of America. So he was a Canadian, actually, by birth. He came out of a staunch Scotch Protestant background. His father died when he was young. He had an injury to his left hand that crippled him all of his life. You seldom see that left hand out where you can see it. At a very young age, he decided that he was going to leave Canada and make his way to the Orient, the Pacific Rim, where he was going to embark in trading with the Far East and make his fortune as a trader in silks and linens and whatever else you trade with the Far East. He got as far as St. Paul, which isn't very east of Canada, took a job on the docks on the Missouri River as a grain merchant, was very good at that, met some very influential people, got into coal, transporting coal, selling coal, mining coal, soon became to realize that the future of transportation in the Midwest was not on the river, it was in railroads. The model in those days for railroads was to connect seaports, and so he could connect the river transportation on the Missouri River, maybe with Puget Sound, and accomplish his dream of reaching the West and the Far East. gained the backing of some influential Canadians, primarily connected with the Hudson Bay Company, got involved in the Canadian Pacific Transcontinental Line for a while, kind of fell out with that, didn't like kind of what they were doing in Canada, and decided that if he was going to do a railroad to the Pacific Ocean, he'd have to do it himself. And for all intents and purposes, he's going to do that. So that's kind of where we come up with him. This is a picture you don't often see of him. This is actually the guy that built the railroad. This is when he's about 45. This is the one you usually see. This is about when he's 75. And at this point, he was retired. Louis Hill, who was president of the railroad, Louis liked to invite him out west, and Hill loved to come. He loved to stand on depot platforms and tell crowds, because he was very popular, about all the wonderful things that the Great Northern had brought to the West and all the stuff he'd done, and he got to be quite a spokesman at this age. So I guess this is the one that everybody likes to think of him. If I had to pick, you know, one of those interesting questions in Montana history, and I suspect you're all pretty good Montana historians or you wouldn't be here. What is the pivotal year when Montana came into its own as a prospective state in the nation? What year was that when it kind of turned the corner from being this frontier outpost trapping beaver to being a producer and a land of farms and ranches and industry and jobs and cities? What year was that? You know, was it 1859 when gold was first discovered? Was it 1864 when Montana became a territory? Was it 1876 when Custer met his end down on the Little Bighorn? Was it 1889 when it became a state? I suspect we all have our opinions about that, but I'm going to pick the year 1884. And I do this for a very clear reason in my mind. 1884 is the first year James Jerome Hill came to Montana to see it for himself, in May of that year. 1884 is also the year that Marcus Daly opened his smelter in Anaconda. And between the two of them and the business that they did together and the business that they brought to the rest of Montana, and oh yes, that wonderful feud that we all know about with Daly, it is going to dramatically change Montana's future into the treasure state that we all know. And the power of ACM Company and the power of the Great Northern Railway combined to do that. Now the truth is, in 1884, Montana already had a railroad. It's that Northern Pacific thing that my wife talked about a month ago. It was a land grant chartered, congressionally chartered, signed into law by Abraham Lincoln Railroad, one of three that was designed to tie the Midwest to the West Coast after the Civil War. It was the third one to be done after the Union Pacific and the Southern Pacific. And it arrived here in Helena in July of 1883 to great fanfare, to great celebration, to great excitement, because the railroad was the internet of the 19th century. If you were online, you were successful. And if you weren't online, you weren't successful. And all you have to do is look at a map of Montana and those cities that grew up along the railroad in the 19th century versus those that didn't, and which ones have survived, which ones are the population centers, which ones are the ones that where most of the business and where the jobs are and where people live. So this railroad was a very important thing when it arrived. And yet by 6 months later, the NP was very unpopular. Now wait a minute, how can you be this great thing that fosters business, that transports things across the nation, and be unpopular? Well, three ways. One, you enter into an agreement with the Union Pacific, who by that time had reached Butte, that you're going to carve up the business of the territory. UP can have Butte, which at that time was a dying silver camp. The NP was going to take Helena, which had more millionaires per capita than New York City at that time. And we're also going to guarantee that we're not going to compete. So we're going to charge the same rates, which are high, because we're not competing. And then we've got all this land, this 450 million acres of land that the U.S. government gave the Northern Pacific to subsidize the building of it across the West. Think about the other end of that. It's 450 million acres that just went out of homesteading, that just went out of production. It's not available for people to develop and to sell and to live on. And so 6 months later, between those three things, the NP is struggling. And oh yes, there's that little problem about how it went bankrupt and investors lost their shirts and et cetera. So there was some hope that there might be yet another railroad come to Helena. And people were very aware of James Jerome Hill in Helena, Montana. They were very aware of his work with the Canadian Pacific. They were very aware that the Canadian Pacific at one time had a plan to build from what's now Lethbridge down into the Fort Assiniboine area north of Great Falls near what's now Havre with a branch line. They hoped with great hope that that would happen, because a lot of Helena business in 1883 was connected with Fort Benton, the head of steamboat traffic on the Missouri River, and people were still thinking in terms of railroads connecting seaports or river ports, as the case may be. Although the truth of that was that the day the last spike was driven on the NP, Fort Benton died as an industrial business center. That put that model out of business right away. But the thinking was still there. So what's Hill up to? In 1879, a man by the name of Paris Gibson arrived at Fort Benton on the steamboat Helena. He was from St. Paul, Minnesota. He was a wool merchant in St. Paul, Minnesota. He had a factory there, but during the 1873 recession, his factory had gone bust, and Paris Gibson had struggled a little bit and not been able to recover. And so, like so many others who populated Montana, He came west, and he came up the Missouri River, and he arrived in Fort Benton in 1879 to make his fortune in what was then called free government land. Translation, they just shrunk the Blackfoot Reservation, and so there was all that Indian land that was available for people to take up. He tried his hand at a lumber store on the docks at Fort Benton for a while, and then he decided that what he was going to do was raise sheep down near where Belt is today, just east of where Great Falls is today. And he did so. And then within the next couple of years, he kind of explored along the Missouri River. He saw those wonderful Great Falls of the Missouri, and this little light bulb went off in his head. Whoa! These are just like St. Anthony's Falls in St. Paul. If I had some capital, I could develop that, and we could make Great Falls, or whatever would be there, he didn't come up with Great Falls yet, an industrial center that would rival St. Paul. Now the thing about Paris Gibson is, and this is one of my questions I told you about, Paris Gibson, when he was in St. Paul, was a friend of, guess who, James Jerome Hill. And while he was in Montana, he and Hill corresponded. I've read a lot of those original letters between Paris Gibson and James Jerome Hill. And Hill was asking him, well, how is it out there? Is there any potential for development? Is there any business? Is there any coal? Coal was the big thing in those days. And Gibson would write back, yeah, yeah, it's really great stuff. I mean, we got water power, we got coal, we got wide open spaces, we got trade through Fort Assiniboine. You should come out here. You should build a railroad out here. Now my question is, and gosh, I searched hard to answer this question. Did Paris Gibson arrive by accident, or was he sent? By 1881, he and Hill are corresponding. That's 2 years before the Northern Pacific is completed. In 1882, Hill is looking at building a branch line from Lethbridge into that area with the Canadian Pacific. By 1887, he's going to build his own railroad out here. Is this all just coincidence, or did the old boy have a plan? And in my heart of hearts, in my secret soul, I think he had a plan. But I can't find any documentation of it, so I'm just going to have to throw that out as a speculation. But Paris Gibson and Hill start formulating plans for what would become Great Falls. By 1885, Hill owns all the water rights along the Missouri River through the Great Falls for 30 miles, clear from the Sun River to the last of the falls on both sides of the river. He has it all. He has coal mines staked out in what became San Coulee and all of that area around Belt. By 1881, he's developing that. By 1885, he has those things already sewed up before the railroad ever shows up. Now enter the picture a couple of other guys. Charles Broadwater, you all know him because you're from Helena, right? He is one of the founding fathers, one of the pillars. You all know the Broadwater Hotel that used to be out here on the west side. Streets are named after Broadwater. Streets are named after Wilder Broadwater, his daughter. He is a pillar of Montana history. And Charles Broadwater is one of those self-made men. He was the son of a merchant in Missouri who got run out of Missouri during the Civil War because he didn't want to fight in the Confederate Army. And he ended up out here after a little stint with the Kansas Pacific guys, learning the railroad trade, and tried his hand at mining down in Bannock and bottomed out mining, and then realized that what the mining camps really needed was beef. And he went over into the Deer Lodge Valley and he bought beef and he herded him down to Bannock in Virginia City, and he became wealthy. And then he realized that part of the trouble with these mining camps is they couldn't get their stuff out and goods in. So transportation was the answer. And of course, before the railroad, transportation was big, bulky wagons pulled by oxen or by draft horses. And so he went to work for the Diamond T freight outfit. Within 3 years, he was running the Diamond T freight outfit. And then he moved to Helena, and then he met Julie Chumrow. Does that name mean anything to anybody? Her father, Mr. Chumrow, was one of the wealthy people over on Helena's west side. He was a big-time Republican, big-time businessman. He had connections in St. Paul. And Charles married her, and he gained the good graces of his father-in-law. And in the course of that, he traveled to St. Paul, and guess who he met? A.H. Wilder. Fooled ya. Who was A.H. Wilder? A.H. Wilder was a big financial mogul out of St. Paul who also knew, now you're ready, now we can do it in unison, James Jerome Hill. That's why Broadwater named his daughter Wilder after A.H. Now this is going to be an interesting thing. It's one of those things apparently where two guys meet and just hit it off. And for whatever the reason, Hill and Broadwater hit it off. And Broadwater knew transportation. He'd been running freight outfits. He knew Montana. He had, after he met A.H. Wilder, he got a lot of U.S. military contracts to supply places like Fort Assiniboine and Fort McGinnis. And he was becoming wealthy as a result. And he and Hill also began to talk about economic prospects, not only in the Great Falls region, but down here in Helena. Remember, Helena now was a big-time mining strike in the early 1880s. You got Marysville and Thomas Cruz and all that stuff going on down here, so it's very attractive. And in the course of that, Broadwater, Gibson, and Hill become business partners, and they begin to plan. Enter another guy, Marcus Daly. That little bandy Irishman that the Walker brothers send up to Butte to look at the Alice mine. You've all heard the story. And within 5 years, he not only owned the Alice mine, but a lot of the other mining properties on Butte Hill. And Daly's the one who realized that the future of Butte was not in silver, which it had been up till that point, but in copper, that ugly, red, yicky stuff that Butte miners hadn't figured out yet how to separate from the amalgam it was locked up in Butte. I'm not a geologist, so don't ask me to explain what amalgam is, but probably somebody in here can. Daly traveled to Swansea, England, where copper was being smelted, studied the processes, did a little bit of homework, decided that he could come up with his own processing plan for dealing with Butte copper, and in the Alice mine alone, he had found a seam of pure copper 32 feet deep that they're still mining today in Butte, Montana, and have for over 100 years. But Butte didn't have enough water. Butte just has a little Silver Bow Creek. He needed more water to run his mining process. So where could he find water? Out at Anaconda. And in 1883, he carves out a new town, which he was going to name Copperopolis. Everybody talked him out of that. And so he named it Anaconda after his first copper mine, which we're stuck with ever after. And in 1884, the first ACM, well, it wasn't actually ACM yet, the first Anaconda smelter opened in Anaconda, Montana, to process copper ore. It was not instantly successful. It struggled for several years. In May 1884, Hill comes to visit Montana. He had never been here before. Now listen to this. He arrives in his private car in Helena, Montana on Friday afternoon behind a Northern Pacific train. He doesn't even get off. He doesn't even let anybody know he's here. The newspapers don't even know he's here. The train goes over Mullen Pass to Garrison, where he is met by a Utah Northern narrow gauge train. Can't take his private car because it's standard gauge. He gets off the NP, gets on to the UNN. The UNN takes him to Butte. Gets there about midnight Friday night. Saturday, he travels the mines in Butte. He travels the smelter in Anaconda. He meets people. Daly had his private correspondence destroyed, you know. We don't have Daly's end of conversations, so it's hard to track this down. One of my other questions is, Daly and Hill had to meet in May 1884. Can you imagine James Jerome Hill going to Anaconda, Montana to look at the new smelter and not talking with Marcus Daly? And yet there is absolutely no record of it. The Anaconda Standard, which is already in publication, is nothing. The Butte, nothing. All that the Butte Herald had to say was a reprint of the Fort Benton news release that Hill was coming, not whatever he did. Be that as it may, Saturday night, Hill and a party of three get on a stagecoach in Butte, Montana, and travel up what's now I-15 through the Boulder Valley, over Boulder Hill, into Helena, where they arrive Sunday. When they get here, there's a carriage waiting for them, driven by Tom Gibson, Paris Gibson's son. He gathers them all up, and they drive all day Sunday up through Wolf Creek Canyon to Sun River Crossing, where they cross the river and go look at the San Coulee coal mines, and then they come back, and then they tour the Great Falls of the Missouri, and then they go down to Big Springs for a barbecue. This is Sunday night. They have a party Sunday night. Monday, he cleans up some business at Big Spring. They get back in the carriage. They come all the way back to Helena, where his private car is waiting for him. And in the wee hours of Tuesday morning, he's on his way back to St. Paul. The Helena Board of Trade is incensed. The least he could have done is top and talk and give us an interview, but not Hill. Now, what was he doing here? And why the big hurry again? Why does he show up on Friday night and gone Tuesday? Now, you think about that journey. If you were got in your automobile and you drove from Helena to Garrison, and then from Garrison to Butte, and then Butte back to Helena up I-15, and then from Helena to Great Falls, and from Great Falls to San Coulee, and then back to Great Falls, and then back to Helena, that would be a pretty good journey, wouldn't it? With modern highways in an automobile. And he did it on a narrow gauge train and a carriage. They must have been exhausted. What's the big deal? Why does he in such a hurry? Yes, he's a busy man. I know he's got to get back to answer the phone. It tells me that Hill has already decided where the business opportunities are in Montana. Through his work with Gibson, Broadwater, and Daly, he knows there's coal in San Coulee. He knows there's water power in Great Falls. He knows there's silver and gold in Helena. He knows there's copper in Butte. And he knows what they really need is a north-south railroad, not east-west, north-south railroad, to tie it together. And it's the perfect scenario for a railroad. You can haul coal south to Anaconda and take those same cars and haul copper back to Great Falls to be processed with all that water power. It is an ideal model. And Hill quotes Marcus Daly, and I do have copies of this correspondence, that he could haul coal from San Coulee to Anaconda for $6 a ton. The UP was charging him $16 a ton to haul coal from Wyoming. Marcus Daly had to love Hill's offer, and they became great friends. So, got to keep this secret from the NP. I mean, the NP's got this area all sewn up, right? And Hill isn't big enough or ready to take the NP head on. So you got to fly under the radar. And how do you do that? Well, you can't hide your presence in Montana, but you can limit it. And you don't give any interviews. And you tell your cohorts not to give any interviews. But still, some news is going to leak out. So maybe what you do is you tell them a story about maybe getting involved in building a branch line. Maybe what we'll do is we'll connect Rimini, where Broadwater had gotten some options on some silver property through Shumrau, to the NP main line at Helena Junction, and we'll just do a branch line. And maybe we'll get involved in this Fort Benton to Helena Railroad project that kind of was looking like it had some legs. Fort Benton realized they were on the wrong end of the stick up there with only water transportation. They were out lobbying hard for a railroad and wanted Helena's founding father, S.T. Hauser, to become involved in it. So maybe what you'd say is, well, we might build that for them. And as long as the NP thinks it's only going to be branch lines that will connect with their main line, where they'll get all the traffic anyway, they don't get too excited. Besides, the NP's broke. What are they going to do? But along about January of 86, the light dawns on the NP, and Helena becomes the epicenter of what's going to be a major, major railroad war, and you are going to be right in the bullseye here in Helena, Montana, for a huge war that very few people have ever heard about, but it was going to change the dynamics in this state forever. And that's the war between the NP and Hill's St. Paul, Minneapolis, and Manitoba / Montana Central, which will become in 1889 the Great Northern Railway. And so that's what this book is all about that we've written, is that war and all the manipulations between the two parties that result in one segment of the Hill Empire, the Montana Central Railway, which was incorporated in January of 1886 under the territorial laws as a separate entity from the St. Paul, Minneapolis, and Manitoba. There are business reasons why you do that. Plus, it also conceals who's behind the effort. And their charter reads they're going to build a line from Great Falls to Helena and then eventually connect to the NP and eventually on to Butte. And will do so in just 2 years. On November the 19th, as I already spoke to, the construction crews reached Helena. That's November the 19th, 1887. There's 3 inches of snow on the ground. The wind is blowing. Does it happen like that in Helena in November? Yeah, I think hang around another 36 hours. We may see kind of what Hill came into. On the 21st, with snow still on the ground, Hill arrives in his private car on the new railroad. And Helena throws a wing-ding celebration. By all counts, 5,000 people are down at the Great Northern Depot, down here behind the old Armory building, behind where Carroll College is today, and that at the bottom of Last Chance Gulch Creek, to meet Hill when he arrives on his private train. There is a parade from the Montana Central Depot up Last Chance Gulch, which when I grew up we always called Main Street, up to Ming Opera House up on Jackson Street next to where the shrine building in the consistory is. They had a big dinner, and Hill spoke to the crowd. And on the 22nd, the Helena Independent published the text of Hill's speech. And it is published verbatim in the book. I'd recommend you read it. It's hilarious. Hill is jabbing the NP big time. And how they're just takes 2 days too long to get here from what we can do it. and how they charge too much and so on. The headline reads, "The seed mill failtha." I'm not a Gaelic speaker, I was probably wrong. It's a reference to Thomas D'Arcy's poem, or Thomas D'Arcy McGee's poem. It means basically a thousand welcomes that the newspaper is giving to Hill. Everybody who's anybody speaks, from the governor on down to the mayor. There are military units in this parade. There are notables in this parade. Broadwater's in the parade. Everybody's in the parade in a blizzard in Helena on Last Chance Gulch to welcome Hill to the state. They are so relieved to see him because they see him as a liberator from the tyranny of the Northern Pacific and its high freight rates and its poor investments and its monopoly on these land grants. And to Hill's credit, he does pretty much that. I guess it's no big secret that Hill won the war. It's not that easy. There are several battles that are fought, and they are interesting as they ebb and flow. They have a huge war up Rimini. The NP's response to Hill's survey crews working up 10 Mile Creek is to send their own survey crews up 10 Mile Creek and to survey a parallel line which would cross the GN line 14 places at grade. And Hill filed suit, and that lawsuit went clear to the Supreme Court. He claimed they were trespassing, which they were. But the Supreme Court decided that in narrow canyon defiles and mountain passes, one railroad couldn't show greater need than another. And so eminent domain couldn't work, and they had to get along. They had to cooperate. Either they had to build separate lines, even if they crossed each other, or one railroad had to give the others trackage rights. Whereupon Hill threw up his hands, abandoned Rimini, and gave it to the NP, and moved his line over into the Boulder Valley. If you go out to, well, you remember where the old Silver Barn is out here on Highway 12? Just past that, and you look at that field just south of the highway, you'll see those two grade lines running out through the field. And the one on the left is the Great Northern Grade, and the one on the right is the Northern Pacific Grade. The Northern Pacific didn't actually build all the way to Rimini before they got theirs built. The Supreme Court made its decision, and they ended up buying the GN grade, and the NP is stuck with Rimini until 1928 when they finally get permission to pull out. The same thing happens at Marysville. The NP arrived at Marysville in 1887. It had plans to build on to Fort Benton, it said. It didn't have the money to do it, but they had plans to do it. They got to Marysville by coming around the hills from Birdseye. You all know where Birdseye is up here, up Austin Creek. On a 3% grade that crossed a bridge with a 13-degree curve in it to get into town. You've probably all seen pictures of that big railroad bridge that used to cross the gulch there where the Drumlin Mill used to be. Right over the top of where the GN Depot Station was, because the GN was building up there from Silver, 6 miles, pretty much what's the road to Marysville these days. That road is on the grade of the Great Northern. And they had sited their depot right there at the Drumlin Mill, not up in town, and the NP built right over the top of them with this big trestle. The GN only saw that out for about 5 years and then abandoned back to Silver again. There's the Ming's Opera House, which is long gone, of course, but was the place in the early days of Helena. And the newspaper ran this interesting graphic of the first car of freight into Helena on the Montana Central. Interesting, it's a Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy car. But anyway, there it is, the first load of freight into Helena via the Montana Central. The Montana Central located its yard facilities at the base of Last Chance Gulch, which had been mine tailings, pretty much scrap land. Right there at Neal Avenue, just below where the Shrine Auditorium is today, the Civic Center. They built depot complex and baggage freight house and all the other good stuffs down there. And then the engine facilities were out at below where Carroll College is today. There was a roundhouse out there and in some yard facilities. And the main line actually ran south of the Northern Pacific, all the way through Helena and out through East Helena before they went south to Butte, which they finally got to in 1888. Let's look at some pictures. Pictures of the early Montana Central facilities are kind of hard to come up with, but here's a nice one out of the Montana Historical Society archives. This is 1896. Taken from the little hill up here on Mount Helena, looking right down Power Street. And you can see the new mansions that are beginning to spring up on Helena's west side. Thomas Power's house is right there, pretty much brand new. Take note of this little string of three right here, two wooden ones and a brick. And then there's one right down here with a nice little turret on it and the three windows. Because if you go up there, 126 years later, or in this case, 121 years later after the photograph was taken, those three little houses right there, now come on, darn it. All right, those little three houses are these three houses here, one, two, three. They're hard to see. The trees are 100 years old. But if you get down on the street, here's the two wooden ones, and here's the brick ones. And they really haven't changed all that much, except for the trees. They're still inhabited. And you notice the little house with a turret on it down here with the three windows in the midst of all the fir trees? It's that same house right there. There it is. A little closer view today. Still looking very nice, very lived in. But the depot yards, which are right there, the depot is this building. This would be Neal Avenue now. It wasn't there in those days. And then the freight yard, and then out here would be the roundhouse. And then off in the distance is the NP facilities. Boy, has that view changed. Not just because of the trees, but look at the construction that's happened down at the base of Last Chance Gulch in the last 120 years. Here's another picture out of the Historical Society of the roundhouse. The interesting thing about this roundhouse, it's only going to be here until 1895. The GN gets in yet another argument with the NP over land, and it closes this roundhouse and moves everything out to Clancy and builds a roundhouse complex at Clancy and moves all of its engine facilities to Clancy and builds the town of Clancy. There was no Clancy until the GN moved out there in 1895, and we'll show you some pictures of that in a bit. And so this was all abandoned here because they got into a land fight with the NP. I can date this about 1896 because notice how the little chimney pots are off the roundhouse. A lot of this stuff that was at the hill in the yard got moved to Clancy and rebuild out there as part of that roundhouse complex. And all the yard tracks are pretty much gone. This is the coal platform. It looks like it's still in some use. Kind of interesting. Old cameras didn't capture motion very well. And there's a little switch engine going down the main line, but he's just a blur. And then there's it looks like another car of coal sit there. And this is the Y track that came out of the Helena yard onto the main line. The NP is here. This is their main line headed for Mullen Pass. Keep your eye on that bridge. We're going to use that bridge as a reference point in the next photo. Has that view changed at all in 123 years? Yeah, just a little. Now, when I was a kid growing up in Helena, behind the armory was the old dump. Some of you who are my age or older remember that. Yeah. And then when the carnivals came to town, they set up on that. Remember, they'd filled over it, but the carnivals set up down there. So, you know, when I was 7, 8, 9 years old going down to the carnival, we were all over this. And I didn't realize it was a hazardous waste area. Maybe that explains why I didn't live very long. I don't know. But anyway, over the efforts of the last few years and a major cleanup down there, most any evidence of the Great Northern Yard in the bottom of Last Chance Gulch has disappeared. But there's that bridge. Remember that bridge? I told you. You know what? I think Brian, my pointer just died. Oh well. Good teachers are improvisers. This bridge right here, remember that bridge? See it up there? Now, this is a concrete bridge built many years later, but the bridge is the same bridge going over the same railroad tracks. That's over the NP main line. So you can kind of anchor yourself by that bridge where you are. And I'm standing in the parking lot behind the old main hall at Carroll College, which I suspect is pretty much where the photographer here was standing in 1896, when that picture was taken. In the 1950s, well, Clancy, the GN finally resolved its land issues with the NP, and in 1925 they closed its Clancy facilities and moved everything back to Helena. Only when they came back to Helena, they didn't have enough traffic in Helena by that time to warrant another roundhouse and all of that terminal. The railroad actually ran in a single division by 1925, all the way from Great Falls to Butte. And so the only thing there was in Helena was the coal tower and some light engine, switch engine facilities. This is about 1950 here. All the buildings down the left side there is the yard office and crew shacks and speeder sheds. The coal tower is abandoned by this time in favor of an oil tank because we've got diesels and they're oil fed rather than coal fed. And it'll be torn down in a short time. But it's still an interesting picture taken from the Last Chance Gulch Bridge. Looking west, you can see the corner of Carroll College, which has been built by now. And I'm standing exactly in the same place 121 years later. Has there been any changes? Yeah, certainly has. BN puts an end to all of that down there. When BN is formed in 1970, then there's no need for the duplicate trackage through Helena because that combined the NP and the GN. And so almost immediately, BN got busy tearing up the track, the GN tracks through Helena. The NP had the better facilities and everything moved over on the NP. If you go down there today, there's one little bit of track out there just a little bit west of the Benton Street crossing at Carroll College, which is the old Montana Central line. It's probably about, 500 yards long where they used to reach across from the NP. And that's about it. You can see a little bit of the grade through Helena to the east of the Last Chance Gulch Bridge where it kind of went through a channel. But otherwise, until you get out east of town, it's been pretty much eradicated. If we look at the depot grounds itself, this is a very early picture, about 1888, the Montana Central Depot grounds in Helena. This inclined street coming down from the right here is coming up to Neal Avenue. The photographer is standing at Neal Avenue. It's not here yet, but the Civic Center Shrine Auditorium would be out of the left of the photograph up on the hill here. Right now, there's a big smokestack there from Helena Power and Light that sat on that facility. And the building at left is the freight house, the baggage shed, the depot, and then you're looking out towards where the engine facilities were. The streetcar line also ran up Neal Avenue, so this was serviced by the Helena streetcar line at this time also. Here's a couple of more recent pictures. The old freight shed lasts forever. This is a 1967 photograph, still sitting there with the Great Northern Goat on it in its original location. This is 1935 aerial photograph down here. Here's the Y track, the Montana Central Main leading into the depot grounds. I realize you can't see it all that clearly, but it's kind of interesting to see how Helen has grown since 1935. In 1913, the Great Northern built a new depot in Helena. This is an interesting story. In 1903, James Jerome Hill had acquired, by that time, control of the Northern Pacific and the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy, and he proposed the first merger of the roads under the Northern Securities Plan. And this kind of batted around in the courts for a while, and ultimately was declared in violation of fair trade by the terms of the Sherman Antitrust Act, and he was forced to divest himself of the NP and the CB&Q, but he still remained financially and corporately in charge. So after about 1907, the corporate finances of both the NP and the CB&Q are entangled with the Great Northern. And the Great Northern will make runs at this again for the next 50 years until finally in 1970, Burlington Northern is approved and Hill's dream of 1903 is finally enacted and permitted. And from that we get BNSF to this day. In 1903, the Great Northern abandoned the old wooden depot in Helena. And it built a track on Robert Street off of Euclid that connected the GN main to the NP main. By 1903, the NP had built its nice new brick depot, which you still enjoy down there at the end of Helena Avenue that Montana Rail links in today. And the GN actually used the NP depot, because they were going to be all one happy family, for about 7 years, until ultimately Hill was forced to divest himself and to separate. And so that interchange was torn up, and the GN at that time built new brick depots in Helena and in Butte. They have the same history from the two of them. So it opens to the public in 1913. It's right at the end of Fuller Avenue on Neal Avenue, just on the north side of the highway. It was a two-story depot. The train platforms were down at track level in what's amounted to the basement. Waiting room, baggage rooms, and lounges was on the main level. And it had this wonderful clock tower. Great Falls and Helena had clock towers on their depots. The 1933 earthquake did end the clock tower in Helena. And so most of us who remember the old GN Depot in Helena remember it without the tower, because that was taken off and was not rebuilt. And it went on to become the Chamber of Commerce building, and ultimately it was torn down to make way for the new Federal Reserve building that's there today. On the upper left, this has to be either under construction or brand new, because you can still see the streetcar line running down Fuller and up Neal Avenue right in front of it. Nothing else has grown around it yet. What we could now call Hill and Woman's Parks aren't even developed. That's just raw stuff. This covered causeway here in the foreground, they put Last Chance Gulch Creek underground, at this time. And it doesn't come out again until you get way out in the dredgings out there where Custer Avenue is today. This is a postcard view in the lower right, probably about 1920, judging from the automobiles. Still shows the streetcar line making the turn in front of the depot. And in the left of that is a brand new, remember Anderson Chevrolet? 1936, this is the delivery of new Chevrolets to the Chevrolet dealer in Helena, and I think it's the same Anderson. I think it's the same company. Those box cars are all full of new Chevys, 1936 Chevys. This is the height of the Depression. Things must have been better in Helena than they were in some places. Notice over to the left is the old freight shed that we saw. That's just a hallmark down there. When I was a kid, I got around, like kids do, with my bicycle. We used to play down there all the time. Don't remember there being a whole lot of activity down there. This would have been in the late 50s. And the thing I do remember is the state liquor warehouse that was down there. That was the primary traffic on the Great Northern at that time. Otherwise, things were pretty decrepit down there. This is something I stole off the Historic Helena website. This is a Google map of Helena as it is today with the footprint of the original Great Northern, well, the 1913 Great Northern Depot, superimposed over the Federal Reserve. I went down there to try to do one of my 121-year later pictures. You can't get close to the place. There's a big steel fence, and there's armed guards, and there's cameras and threatening signs. So I stole it off the website. I didn't want to go to jail. But this is the footprint of the old depot. This is the new Federal Reserve building. This is all fenced off with armed guards and big dogs. And then you got that great big movie theater complex beyond that. So you really can't get close to where the old depot was anymore. In the 1950s, the Great Northern built yet another depot in Helena. By this time, traffic was winding down pretty good. They had reduced passenger service to what they call a bud car, which is a self-propelled car that ran between Great Falls, well, actually between Havre and Butte. And then on alternating days, went from Great Falls to Billings, on the old Billings in Northern. And this will last up until 1961, when it's discontinued altogether. That's the depot that they built out at the intersection out there where Montana, Euclid, and Helena Avenue all came together. And I can remember, if you got stuck between the Great Northern and the NP tracks, when there were trains on both things, you could be there for quite a while. There was no way out of there. You guys remember that, some of you old-timers down there? And if you can imagine how busy that intersection is, just put a set of train tracks through there and see how it is. This building is gone. There's a casino on that corner. The upper right, I've been told that's a picture of the last run of the Bud car in 1961 when it was discontinued with the last crew. It was a Great Falls crew. I think one of those gentlemen is still alive. Other things in Helena from the Montana Central, the old Broadwater. I remember the Broadwater. It was abandoned when I was a kid. Didn't stop us. We went out and explored it and survived to tell about it. The only thing that's out there, the grounds are still available, I guess, for weddings and things. And the old gymnasium building, isn't the gymnasium that still stands out there? I think that's what I was told is all that's there. There's bits and pieces of it around Helena and other places that were sold off in the 70s when the building was torn down. It was kind of a hard luck story. Broadwater only lives till 1892. He gets pneumonia and dies quite suddenly. Shortly after the Broadwater Hotel opened, his son took it over. His son, his name was Charles. About 3 years later, they went belly up. It sat empty for a long time, and then it was sold, and then it reopened, and then I guess during World War II, the Army wanted to buy it as an adjunct to Fort Harrison. To house soldiers, and they couldn't get together on price, so that didn't happen, and it was pretty much abandoned in all modern times, but was a grand hotel. At one time, both the GN and the NP and the Helena streetcar system serviced the Broadwater Hotel, and there are lots of pictures of it with all three things there. That's as far as the GN built up 10 Mile Creek was there. Broadwater had his Montana Bank, a building that no longer exists, but A.H. Wilder and Hill were large contributors to the Montana Bank that Broadwater built. And Hill wanted to know why Broadwater was going to invest so much money in a town that sagebrush was going to be growing in the main street in 10 years. And Broadwater, despite him, had this buffalo chiseled as a symbol of the staying power of Helena and the buffalo and, you know, whatever it symbolized. And you can see it. There, over the front door of the Montana Bank. And it was saved during the big urban renewal push, and it now sits outside the Helena Public Library up at the south end of Last Chance Gulch. So you can still go pet the buffalo. And I don't think sagebrush is growing in Last Chance Gulch yet, but almost. Well, unfortunately, anything else in Helena has pretty much disappeared. It's connected with the Great Northern and the Montana Central. The new Best Western down there in the old Great Northern Yard is called the Great Northern Hotel, and they have a lot of Great Northern memorabilia in there. But if you go down there and you talk to the clerks about the Montana Central and Helena Yard and the fact that their hotel is right in the middle of it, they get this big, round-eyed, what? Look. Next July, the Great Northern Railway Historical Society is going to have their national convention in that hotel starting July 11th. And the center of the activity is Montana Central. So if any of you found your way down there in July, I'm sure they would love to have you attend the convention and participate in, it's usually a number of presentations. I know they're going to take a bus tour both to Great Falls and also to Butte to look at Montana Central stuff. And Jan and I have been enlisted to guide one of the buses, so be forewarned. We can't talk about Helena, though, without talking about Clancy, because the two of them are pretty connected, even today. And I think half the commuters working at the Capitol come out of what we used to call Gruger Estates out there in that Clancy area. And Clancy is a creation of the Great Northern Railway in 1895 as a result of its land feud with the NP in Helena. They couldn't agree to terminal grounds. And so they moved 15 miles out of town to some non-NP land, and they laid out not only a yard and an engine complex, but a town. If you look at the old houses in Clancy, they take on somewhat of a uniformity. There's little four-square houses with a chimney out the center, which is pretty much of a Great Northern kind of thing. And Clancy originally was a railroad town. And the railroad between 1895 and 1925 operated in two divisions. It operated from Great Falls to Clancy, where engines were serviced and turned and so forth. And then the second division was from Clancy to Woodville. You don't even know where Woodville is, do you? Good for you. Woodville, right at the top of the Elk Park Pass Hill coming out of Butte, which was actually the Butte yard limits. They built Woodville up there to keep those heavy trains from having to go down that 3% grade into town and vice versa. I'll talk more about that in just a minute. And this is a 1900 timetable. Trains south were scheduled and would have been loaded with coal, largely, and other things going south. Trains north, except for the passenger train, were unscheduled, always extra. When they got enough stuff, they put a train together at Woodville. Switch engines brought cuts of cars up that steep hill, put them together in a major yard complex at Woodville, and when they got enough tonnage, they went north. So that's what the timetable tells us. Clancy had the coal tower. This is about 1898. It got bigger over the years. It also had a nine-stall roundhouse. You can see down here in the lower right, the roundhouse. If you go to Clancy today, where the fire department has their new building, that big expanse of black stuff is where that yard was. And right in the middle of that black stuff is a sign for the Hotel 6, and that's where the roundhouse was. So if you ever want to go out there and look at it, you'll see absolutely no sign of it other than the black stuff, but that's where it was. There was water tank and all that stuff that happened there. This lasts till 1925 when they move everything back to Helena. But in its day, it was a busy place. It's fun. Jan and I just went up there today, and we tried to find out where this upper left picture was taken. I always love to find where the picture was taken. And then the next question is, why? Why was the guy up here taking the picture? But God love him. I'm glad he did, because, boy, that's the only evidence we have of that. But we couldn't get up there. There's a house up there now, but we got close. And when you look across to that hill, which looks pretty barren, it's full of trees now. It's always the thing. When you look at century-old pictures, there's always fewer trees than there are today. So despite global warming and all the other stuff that's happened, the truth is a century later we got more trees. Even with the beetles, we got more trees. Well, half of them are dead, I know, but we got them. And a lot of that is because This country was just about denuded to supply cordwood to the mining operations at Butte and Basin and Elkhorn and even the Asarco smelter out here in East Helena and Wicks before that. Even when they started using coke made charcoal, that was created from burning trees into cinders, kind of like charcoal in your barbecue, and it took thousands of trees to make enough charcoal to do much smelting work. And so one of the things you find in the early newspaper accounts of the Montana Central is the millions of cords of cordwood that are stacked up along the right-of-way to move north and south to Butte or to some of the other mining locations. All right, I'm hurrying. Okay, we're almost done. Okay. There's two big features that you can still see south of here. One is the Corbin Trestle. Does everybody know where Corbin's at? This bridge still stands. Very impressive bridge. Still there, but you can't walk across it because they took all the ties off. But the features largely in a lot of early photographs because it's the biggest bridge on the Montana Central and a lot of other things. This is a quick shot up at Wicks. The other big thing up there is the Boulder Tunnel, 6,145 feet long. When built, was the longest tunnel on the Great Northern Railway, the third longest in the United States. It remains the longest tunnel on the Great Northern Railway until 1929, when the new Cascade Tunnel was built under the Cascade Mountains. And one of the other questions is why? Why does Hill go to the expense of doing that? Because in 1887-88, Hill wasn't at all sure that his extension west to the coast wouldn't take off from Butte. Because that in those days, you had the Indian reservation at Browning. He did not have permission to pass through it. And so they looked at that and built the Montana Central to mainline standards so that if it did need to serve as the mainline west, it could do so. Very impressive piece of masonry. We spend a lot of time in that in the book. It has a very interesting story in its own right. It still exists. Some people I know have driven through it, which I wouldn't recommend. but interesting. This is Boulder, 1917. I love these pictures. What were those kids doing? You know, they're getting to go somewhere, and they're going to have a lot of fun doing it, I bet, because they all got smiles on their faces. 1917. Probably before our involvement in World War I, so maybe they're going off to school or something. But this is actually the original Boulder Depot, which is to sit down in town when the GN built through there in 87, 88. It was actually down in town, and then in 1900, to eliminate the south side of the hill as a helper district, they moved everything up on the hill. And I think you probably all know where Depot Hill Road goes up the hill there out of Boulder. And where the old depot was, this one burned down in 1925. Lightning hit it. And so they replaced it with the depot that's now being used as the Boulder Senior Citizen Center, which still exists. 1917, there was a bad boiler explosion between Basin and Boulder. That's the wreck up there. And then there's people that walk around those places and so on. I'm hurrying, Brian. Honest, I am. This is building Tunnel 7 and the crossovers up there between Basin and Boulder. You can still see the pylons of that bridge in the river if you know where to look. You can still see Tunnel 7, which is what's under construction in this photo, but you can't see that caboose that the rock fell on when they were cementing the tunnel. Basin at one time had two railroads, both the NP and the GN. There is absolutely nothing left in Basin that would show you either railroad was ever there. The freeway took out, went right down the GN yards. The NP pulled out of there in 1905, so everything's pretty gone, but interesting. Woodville, I've talked about a little bit. Pictures of Woodville just don't exist. This is the only one I could ever find. This is sometime before 1924 when the coal tower burned down and it was discontinued. This served as the northern yard limits for Butte,
which means that switch engines could work out of Butte up here. I've already described kind of how trains work, but if you look at this photograph, you can see there's about a mile worth of gondola cars out there running south of the coal tower. That's the volume of traffic, coal south, copper north, that GN was hauling out of Butte. And keep in mind, they were just one of five railroads serving Butte. So that gives you some idea of the traffic. Highest point on the Great Northern Railway was Elk Park Pass at the top of Woodville Hill. That sign is still there. I probably shouldn't ever say that. The minute I say that, then I worry about vandals having at it. But you guys don't look like you're going to be vandals. If you get off the Woodville exit, drive towards Butte on the old highway, you can see this sign. That's the original Great Northern sign. Butte itself has a long and interesting history. I wish we had more time tonight to talk about that and show you more pictures. Brian, maybe you need to invite me back someday. We can talk about Butte, okay? Thank you.